Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice like the ocean depths. You care for people and animals alike, O Lord. How precious is your unfailing love, O God. All humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Today I have with me all you brothers and sisters who believe in Jesus and whom God promises, Jesus promises eternal life. And God also promises, as the church teaches us in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 1026, that by his death and resurrection, Jesus Christ has opened heaven to us. Now, one question. If God has opened heaven to us, does that mean all Christians go to heaven? Okay. Now, remember that God has given all of us a precious gift which nobody can match, and that is the gift of free will. So depending on your life with Christ, you choose to be with God forever, or you choose to stay separated from God forever. Matthew 7:14, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are very few. Now, this is in direct contrast to what we hear these days and to what the world tells us. And a lot of Catholics also have kind of taken into this. They think that everybody, especially if you look at funerals and whenever somebody passes away, it is assumed that the person goes directly to heaven. But see what the word of God says. The gate is narrow and the way is hard. See what St. John Vianney says. He says, shall we all be saved? Shall we go to heaven? Alas, my children, we do not know at all. But I tremble when I see so many souls lost these days. See, they fall into hell as leaves fall from the trees at the approach of winter. This is said by the same St. John Vianney. So whilst we are in the world, we do not conform to the ways of the world, but we believe in the word of God. And we also look at what the saints tell us who have gone before us, leading such holy lives. Now, the Catechism of the Catholic Church in paragraph 1022 says, each man receives his eternal retribution in his immortal soul at the very moment of his death, in a particular judgment that refers his life to Christ, either entrance into the blessedness of heaven through a purification, or immediately, or immediate and everlasting damnation. In short, what the church teaches us, that as soon as you die, you are faced with your particular judgment, and it's at that moment itself that the decision, that the judgment is made, two places, either heaven or hell, depending on how you have lived your Christ, or lived your life. Revelation 21:27 says, but nothing unclean shall enter it, nor, that is heaven, nor anyone who practices abomination or falsehood, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. So we are saying that those with no blemishes on their souls, that is, no stain of sin, who are perfectly purified, immediately enter heaven. This is a Catechism of the Catholic Church 1023 paragraph. And those who have not repented and confessed their mortal sins will go to hell, which is Catechism of the Catholic Church paragraph 1035. Now, we know that the saints who have gone before us have led such holy lives, and they did not have the stain of sin, and many of them were taken directly into heaven. So where does the majority of the people lie? Okay, we see that when we die, many of us will not fit into these two categories. We are neither so holy that we can gain an immediate entrance into heaven, neither are we so attached and unrepentant so as to be punished forever in hell. So what happens to the others? We enter into the blessedness of heaven, okay? There is an entrance into the blessedness of heaven, but it is only after, through a purification or after a purification, and that what is purgatory all about, okay? You are assured of your salvation. You will go to heaven, but it will be only after a purification. So we'll just look at basic concepts for you to understand, and then we'll go into details of praying for others and all, but basic concepts for you to understand and be convinced what is purgatory, so that you can understand yourself and then you can share with others. Now, Jesus's death allows everyone the possibility of heaven. By his death, passion, death, and resurrection, he has won the victory over death, and all of us can go to heaven. And by his sacrifice on the cross, his mercy grants forgiveness. But remember that his justice demands that good be rewarded and evil be punished, either in this life or the next. So if I'm saying there are two people, one man is struggling to live a good and holy life, and is leading a selfless life, a life of obedience to the word of God, and is doing what God wants him to do. And the other one, side by side, is living a life of selfishness, greed, comfort. Do you think they'll be allowed into heaven side by side? No. It is God's justice. It is a requirement of divine justice that good be rewarded and evil be punished in this life or the next. This is one scenario where one is totally into the wrong life and one person is totally in the right life. The second scenario is that yes, one is completely, for example, say John is leading a holy life in obedience to the commandments of God, in obedience to the word of God, loving others and leading a selfless life. And there is, say, Stanley, the second person, who is living a life, a selfish life, who is living a very immoral life, is a gambler, is a womanizer, and he's living a sinful life. Now, at the moment of death, okay, before dying, Stanley at the last minute repents. Okay, he repents and he receives his salvation because he has repented. But do you think that John and Stanley will be allowed to walk into the gates of heaven side by side? So what is purgatory? Let's understand the concept. Firstly, it comes from the word purgatorium, which comes from pagare, which means to purge. Now, purge is basically to get rid of whatever is impure or undesirable. It is to cleanse or to purify. So purgatory is basically a cleansing process, a purification process. The Catechism of the Catholic Church tells us in paragraph 1031 that the Church gives the name purgatory to this final purification of the elect, which is entirely different from the punishment of the damned. Okay, now remember that this term purgatory was coined in the Middle Ages at the councils of Florence and Trent, but that doesn't mean that the Catholic Church did not believe in it. The Catholic Church, the early fathers, the saints, all believed in purgatory and all used to pray from the beginning, from the first century itself, to pray for the others and for the souls of the departed. So this is a long-standing practice in the Catholic Church. Only the word, it was coined together at the councils of Florence and Trent. Okay. Now it says that it is entirely different from the punishment of damned. Now we know that where if you have led a good life without sin of stain of sin, you go to heaven. And if you are unrepentant, not repented of your mortal sins, you go to hell. But there is a middle stage, okay, where you have repented of your sins. But what happens is, it is like a waiting room, okay? So why is that waiting room? So who goes to purgatory? See, usually it is taken for a place, but the church tells us that it is a condition of souls which at the moment of death are in the state of grace. What is the meaning of state of grace? Without mortal sin, but who have not completely expiated. What is the meaning of expiated? Made reparation for their faults or sins, nor attained the degree of purity to enjoy the vision of God. So I'll explain this further. This is the basic. Remember that sin has two consequences or punishments. Okay, we sinned, we went far away from God, and Jesus came down, he died for us so that he could pay this punishment for our sin. So what he has paid is the eternal debt, okay? Eternal punishment. So today, Jesus has opened the doors of heaven for us by taking the sin on himself. Matthew 25, 46 says, and they will go into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So whilst Jesus has done that for you, now it is your free will to do good or to do wicked. He has done it for you, but you know that sin has two consequences. One is eternal punishment. We'll not talk that much about that because today we are a body of believers who believe in Jesus and believe in the salvation of the Lord. Amen. So we will look at the second part for you to understand what is temporal punishment. Okay. Temporal punishment is punishment in time. I'll tell you for what also. So you go through this punishment either here on earth, you can do it, or in purgatory. So the temporal punishment will remain even after your sin is forgiven. So I'll explain it to you. Adam and Eve sinned, okay? They were forgiven by God, but they had to bear the punishment. They were thrown out of paradise when they sinned. The Israelites were forgiven every time they repented, but they lost the privilege of seeing the promised land because they committed the sin of worshiping the golden bull. Now, third example, David. He confesses his sin of adultery, and the prophet Nathaniel tells him that the Lord has forgiven him. David repents and the Lord forgives, but he still had to suffer the death of his child as a consequence of sin. To make it more clearer to you, do some, for that matter, any Christian or more Christians, still have an unhealthy attachment to the worldly things even after being saved? Do we still tend to sin? One second. Do we still tend to sin despite accepting Christ as our Savior? Third, if salvation had come to Zacchaeus' house, why was he still going to recompense the victims of his wrongdoings? Fourth, if I break my neighbor's window and ask his forgiveness, isn't his window still broken until someone fixes it? Whose responsibility is it to fix the window? Okay, you have sinned. Okay, you have broken the window. Fine. You have asked for forgiveness. You have repented. And yes, the sin is forgiven. But that window is still broken. So whose responsibility it is to fix the window? So if you haven't fixed the window yet, you will have on this earth, if you haven't done it, you haven't made what is called satisfaction or reparation, you will have to bear the same punishment in purgatory. Okay, so eternal punishment, you know what it is. It's permanent and it's a punishment due to mortal sin. Temporal punishment is end is definite. One day it will get over and the soul will be released to heaven. Therefore, it's temporary and it has been given to you because of your faults which have not been expiated, your sin that is forgiven, mortal sins and venial sins. All right. So what we are talking about is purgatory, where you're where you face the temporal punishment for sin. So from that comes the understanding of why purgatory and what are the purposes of purgatory. Two main purposes. And this is beautiful to understand. The moment you understand it, your purgatory concept is clear. You'll be able to share it with others and lead a life of amends and reparation. The first one is the cleansing from attachment to sin. And the second one, as we mentioned before, the temporal, that is in time punishment for sin. This is required because nobody can enter heaven till you're fully purified. Okay. The first one, attachment, is to sin. You know, many of us, we know that being in a state of grace, we know that means no mortal sin, that you've gone for your confession, you have repented, gone for your confession, and your mortal sins have been cleared. But the second part of it, which people miss out, is you have to hate the sin. God calls us to have nothing to do with sin, not even venial sins, because we know that man, because of original sin, has an inclination towards sin. And sometimes when we sin, we know that there is pleasure attached to it. So many a times we don't do something wrong, which is really bad. I may not go in for an abortion because I know I've heard the teaching, but sometimes if at any point in time, if you're faced with the situation, you may entertain the thought of it. Okay. Or for example, something like adultery, you know that you are going to be punished for this sin, that it has, it has a grave consequence. So what you do is, whilst you might be entertaining some lustful thoughts in your mind, you actually don't go and commit the sin. Now, this is something which is called an attachment to sin. Now, we have to get rid of this. Whilst we don't have mortal sin in our lives, we also have to get rid of any pleasure, any attachment that we derive from any sin, even venial sins. So we cannot have any attachment. So what's the moment of death? If you had any attachments to sin, all this will be purified in purgatory. Okay. Now, why is this required? You know, because that's what God wants from us. Our hearts have to be so pure that we have to be united with God in a perfect union of love through all eternity. It has to be the perfect union. You cannot have any little bit lingering pleasures or attachments to sin. If you have that, you will not get this. You will not have a perfect union of love. And before we enter heaven, we have to have that perfect union of love. And that's why God in his love is purging you, but his justice requires that you make reparation. Okay, that cleansing is required. So the first one is you have to get rid of any attachment to sin. So we have to develop that practice of hating sin. Many of us, I know, if you fall into sin or we have some venial sins, we ask for forgiveness, but we have to develop a hate because God hates sin. Develop a hate even for the small sins, the sins of addictions, small faults, venial sins, all sins. The second one, as I mentioned, the temporal punishment is the after effect of sin or a consequence of sin. So when you ask for forgiveness, there are two aspects. When you sin, you repent, you are sorry for your sins, you ask for forgiveness, and God forgives you. He doesn't give you a second thought. He doesn't give it a second thought. He forgives you. But even after you're forgiven, there is still some damage repair to be done. Your guilt is gone, but the damage is there. So if you have spoiled your neighbor's name, if you have stolen, okay, You have to make reparation. If you have stolen the goods or stolen money or cheated somebody, you have to make amends. Now that, if you have not done in this life, then you will have to go through the purging in purgatory. That is what is temporal, what you mean by temporal punishment. All purging is painful. Today, if you sin, something you like to do, an addiction, and then you're trying to get rid of that addiction, it is painful. But the purging in purgatory is extremely painful. And we'll come to it when I'll share with you the examples of the saints and the stories of how painful it is. See, we are here on earth, do not and cannot understand the pains of purgatory. Even the slightest stain of sin is very grave, very serious in the eyes of God. And there is too much of pain. It says that no human tongue can describe this intense pain which the suffering souls must endure in this process of purification. And there is double pain. The main pain is that you are not still allowed to meet God. You are not still allowed to see God. Okay, that is a big thing, because as the moment we die, the whole spiritual realm is open to us and we understand things as we are. Here on earth, we do not. Second one is the pain of sense. They suffer, and they suffer terribly. And I'll show it to you by the quotes of the saints and by the examples. The saints speak. The least pain in purgatory, they say, is greater than the greatest suffering in this world. And it is said, St. Thomas Aquinas says, the same fire torments the reprobate in hell and the just in purgatory. So the fire is the same. See what the Holy Bishop says, St. Cyril. And I'll give you one example and a real life story about this portion as well. A man ought rather to suffer all earthly torments simultaneously until the end of the world than to spend a single day in purgatory. And Saint Padre Pio says, our fire in comparison with the fire of purgatory is a refreshing breeze, and that the average soul spends at least 100 years in purgatory. See, Saint John Vianney says the same thing, that the fire of purgatory is as the same as the fire of hell. The scripture reference for this is 1 Corinthians 3, 12, 15, where it talks about the fire. But the duration of purgatory. The duration of purgatory is, nobody knows. It is basis what God decides, but it depends on the amount, the number of sins, and the severity of sins. So how you've lived your life, if you've lived a very, very sinful life, then the duration will be more. Also, it's taken into consideration if you have deliberately sinned, the malice and the deliberation. And also the third point is, if you've done any reparation or amendment, it's important. So if you've done any reparation or amendment here in your life, you can be sure that your time or duration of purgatory will be reduced when you go there. Now, here on earth, we think that, you know, purgatory, we think of it as in one day is okay. You think, okay, 1-2 days of purgatory is fine. But to the suffering souls, a few hours are like years in purgatory and years like centuries. So I'll give you the examples of this as well. So see what this Sister Francesca says. Now, it's very important to remember that those who are in authority and those who have been given accountability of souls will be judged more severely. So look at the list that's given. A holy bishop is spending about 59 years in purgatory just because of some negligence in his high office. Another bishop, 5 years. He was known as a very generous person and used to always give alms, but he suffered these 5 years in purgatory because he wanted dignity. Now, this is a grave one. A priest suffered 40 years in purgatory because through his negligence, some sick persons had died without the sacraments. If we look at people, if you look at the last one, 35 years only for worldliness. The second last one, a gentleman who had fondness for playing cards for money, for gambling, he had to spend 64 years in purgatory. Now, this is your time span if you have been sinning, and especially if you are in authority, then the punishment is more severe. This we have discussed is that if you need to enter into heaven, you have to be pure because God is inconceivably pure. We cannot imagine. Sorry. System is slightly slow. Also, why do we spend so long? Okay, somebody accessing the screen from there. Sorry about this. Why is the duration sometimes so long? Because we think, okay, few venial faults. But if you have not made reparation for the faults, then it continues, it multiplies, 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 and multiplies, and you have to do reparation for all. Okay? And for mortal sins, which we have confessed, you have confessed, you're forgiven, but you need to do reparation for that. It is said by the saints that for each mortal sin, you nearly need to have 7 years or equivalent in purgatory. 7 years. The Bible says in Proverbs, I think it's chapter 24, verse 16, that the just man falls 7 times a day. So we are not even that righteous. So imagine, so even if you take 10 faults or 20 faults a day, multiplied by the number of days in 2 years, you can imagine how much reparation we have to do for the faults that we have committed. In the olden times, the saints encouraged people to do penance, to do reparation, to do satisfaction. And that's why, any small fault, they would do penance because they knew if they do it here on earth, they needn't do it in purgatory, or it will become lesser in purgatory. Now, this is a very important one, brothers and sisters. It's time that we make reparation and satisfaction the way the church calls us to. And the church is very clear. It tells us what we have to do and why we have to do. Okay, so I'll read the second part. We know that we sin against our neighbor and we have to return stolen goods, restore the reputation of someone slandered, pay compensation. Absolution takes away sin, but it does not remedy all the disorders a sin has caused. Hence, we have to make amends, we have to make satisfaction, we have to expiate the sins, and this is also called penance. So you may say, you may think it's so difficult, or it's a daunting task. But remember, Saint Therese of Lisieux has put it very beautifully. She says that heaven is the rule and purgatory is the exception. Okay? That means as a rule, we have to aim for heaven. Okay? And in case we are not able to make it, then purgatory for cleansing. But she says now the order is reversed. Purgatory has become the rule and heaven has become the exception. We are trying to aim at least for purgatory. But no, God wants us to aim for heaven. And now the exception has become heaven. No, we have to aim for heaven and purgatory has still to be the exception. So remember a few points for you to avoid purgatory here on earth. Abstain from mortal sin, avoid deliberate and grave venial sin, break off bad habits, do penance. If you can read The Little Way of Saint Therese, she tells you, you needn't do big things, but in small things, you can do a little modifications and please God. Daily acts of self-restraint, daily acts of patience with others, daily acts of kindness to others. One thing which the Catholic Church very beautifully talks about is suffering. When you get suffering, bear them calmly and patiently for the love of God, and in them you can do penance for your sins. frequent confession, communion, and holy mass. Pray to God, okay, just as we say in the Hail Mary, that pray to God at the time of our death. And a very important one, resignation to death. The saints say when a sick person becomes aware that he is dying and offers to God his death with perfect resignation, it is very likely that he will go straight to heaven. You all know all of this, extreme unction, indulgences, purgatory, and the important one is also that we are called to pray for the dead. Maccabees 12:46, it is therefore a holy and wholesome thought to pray for the dead that they may be loosed from sins. Now, this is not a new thing. The church has been following it. Even the Jewish tradition, they followed it. You can do nothing more pleasing to God than to aid the suffering souls. Our divine Savior said to the Venerable Marie Lataste, every prayer, howsoever poor it may be, if said for the souls in purgatory, it is acceptable to me on account of the great desire I have for their release. And look at the last one. Let us not hesitate to help those who have died and to offer our prayers for them. So we have to pray because they cannot pray for themselves. Yeah? Why do we pray for them? Because once your time on earth is over, you cannot merit anything. You cannot do anything. It's over. Whatever you have to do, if you have to repent, you have to pray, you have to make amends, you have to make reparation, everything is over here. They cannot help themselves. A. B is they are in horrible pain and suffering, and you can give relief to them. Also, you can hasten their release. So you can make their duration of their purgatory shorter. And they will thank you for it. And once they reach heaven, they will pray for you. Our Mother Mary is a special aid for the souls in purgatory. It is said that whenever we say the rosary for a soul in purgatory, the soul feels, gets relief and sees that all the fires are diminished. And it's a big relief. We know that many, by the saints tell us that many souls are released from purgatory on Mother Mary's feast days, her date of Assumption and Immaculate Conception. She takes them into heaven and she's a special aid and she's a consolation for the souls in purgatory. So it is very beneficial when we approach a mother for the souls in purgatory. Okay. These are the different ways of assisting the poor souls. Mass, communion, indulgences, prayer, sacrifices, offerings, works of mercy, service of neighbor, and all these ways, you know it. Also, special aids for the poor souls, precious blood, Gregorian masses, holy water, adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, so on and so forth. I will share this presentation for you. Our Lord said to Saint Gertrude that when you recite this prayer in a state of grace, 1,000 souls from purgatory are released when you recite this prayer. But remember, it has to be said in the state of grace. Okay? Eternal Father, I offer thee the most precious blood of thy divine Son, Jesus, in union with the masses said throughout the world today, for all the holy souls in purgatory, for sinners everywhere, for sinners in the universal church, and those in my own home and within my family. There's a small spelling error over there. So let us give all the alms we can afford. Let us have said all the masses in our power. Let us hear as many more as is possible. Let us offer all our pains and sufferings for the relief of the holy souls, and we will deliver countless souls from purgatory who will repay us 10,000 times over. I will just give one part of indulgences. That is when the church has prescribed certain good works that can be done for these souls, okay? And when you do it, what the church has prescribed, you get an indulgence. That is, you get either a complete waiver of the punishment of your sin or a part waiver every time you do it. I won't go in details, but this one thing is very important, which I want to share with you. Oh, the slide. Remember, general conditions for gaining an indulgence. So you, whilst you may pray, but your prayers to be efficacious and to get what God is telling you, the church is telling you, you can achieve, you have to be in a state of grace, no attachment to sin. You have to make a good confession to a priest and receive Holy Communion. Typically, if it is a plenary indulgence, you have to pray for the intentions of the Holy Father. And these indulgences which you can get for yourself, or you can also apply it for the souls in purgatory. Now, I want to share with you now some examples from the saints and what the saints, you know, they had a lot of apparitions from the souls. Why? Because the saints used to pray a lot for these holy souls. So God in his mercy allowed these souls to come and share with them certain things, which is now made known to us. The first one I want to share with you is with regards to the existence of purgatory. Now, there was this Polish prince who was exiled for some reason from Poland, and he was spending his time in France. Now, he had lost his faith. What faith he had of a Catholic in the childhood, he lost his faith. And now, to make things worse, he was writing a book against God. Now, one day what happened was he was strolling in the garden, and there was a lady who was weeping away. And she asks him, "Why are you weeping?" And the lady tells her that her husband worked for this king, and her husband died 2 days back, but he had a serious sickness. So she spent all her money in the husband's medicines, and she didn't have any money. She wanted some money so that she could offer masses for this soul. And the prince is kind enough. He feels bad for her and he gives the money, and she goes and offers mass for his soul. And it so happened that when he was in his book, in his study, writing that book, someone knocks on the door. And after a loud knock, he tells that person to come in. And then he sees a visitor who is there in front, okay? And when he looks up, he sees that servant who died 2 days before, his name was John Marie, that person is in front of him. And that person, that soul, has come to thank the prince that he gave the money for the masses and that he was released from purgatory. And before going, he tells this Polish prince that, "Prince, there is a God, there is a future, there is a heaven, there is a hell." And he tells about purgatory. Okay, after that, the prince falls on his knees and he recites the "I believe," and his faith is returned. Now, the second one, there is a priest. Okay, this is about the duration in purgatory. I'm trying to tell you because these people are, some of them are very holy people. All right, so in the same manner, there was a certain priest, very holy, very penitent, so much so that the Lord had revealed to him that he's going to die shortly, okay? And had told him that when you die, ensure that the mass is offered up for you. So he tells his very close friend of the warning, and that friend tells him, yes, definitely, that he will offer the mass for him as soon as possible after death. Now, no sooner had the good priest breathed his last, the friend priest goes to fulfill his promise. Now, when he is fulfilling the promise, he offers a sacrifice of the holy sacrifice of mass, and he beseeches God to help his friend and to have pity on the soul of the departed. Now, the priest is making his thanksgiving after mass, and the soul comes to him and appears before him radiant and with holy joy. That means that he will be going to heaven. He's radiant and with holy joy. But he's telling him, "Why didn't you keep your promise? So badly you kept your promise. You left me in purgatory for a whole year. And during all this time, you or none of the fathers offered a mass for me. the priest, his friend, gets shocked. He says, he replies to him that he has just finished the mass, which he started immediately after the priest's death, and that the remains are still awaiting burial. So whilst for us, it may be 15 minutes, but for them, it feels like a year. Now that is the difference in the duration of time here on earth and the duration of time in purgatory. Hence, we cannot make things light, okay? We have to live a holy life and make reparations. Now there is another one, okay, where it talks about a different story. Saint Antoninus and his friend, okay? Both were friends and one of them passes away. Many masses were offered, many suffrages, that is intercessions and prayers, were offered for this soul, okay? And the priest, Saint Antoninus, thinks he must have been released and gone into heaven. But he's very surprised when after a very long time, the soul of this gentleman comes to the Saint Antoninus and he says, Saint Antoninus says, are you still in purgatory? Because you led such a pious and devout life. What this soul says. In spite of living a holy and devout life, he says, yes, I'm in purgatory and I'll remain there for some time, because when I was on earth, I neglected to pray for the souls in purgatory. And because of that, he had to be detained in purgatory. It is said that Mother Mary releases a whole lot, multitude of souls on the feast days, especially on the Assumption of Mother Mary. And she promises her children, Mother Mary promises her children, those who recite the Holy Rosary every day, that she will personally deliver them from purgatory. Okay? Now the value of the Mass. Again, there were two friends. You know, we've seen a lot of examples where the saints and the pious people always encouraged a close person of theirs to say masses for them after their death. Maybe this is a practice that we can also start, because it is very efficacious, very beneficial. The Mass is the greatest. So it brings great benefit to a person and can release the person from purgatory. So even in this case, we see that Blessed Henry Suso and his friend, the same thing happened. The friend told Blessed Henry Suso that decided that whoever goes away first will come back and tell the person the condition of the person, okay? And they decided that for the whole year, they will say masses on Monday, a mass of requiem, and on Friday, the day of the passion, the mass, another mass, okay? Now, what happened was Blessed Henry Suso did it, but during the course of time, what he did was he continued to pray. He prayed very fervently and he did everything what they had to do, penances and good works and everything. But he did not think of offering the masses which he had promised a number of years earlier. He had promised that he will offer these many masses. And then one morning that soul comes to him. And Blessed Suso, Henry Suso, is very, very surprised. And he understands that, you know, what happens is this person says, Henry Suso is asking, is it possible, dear brother, that so many prayers and good works which I have done for you is not enough? And the brother, see what he replies. He says, no, oh no, these are not sufficient. It is the blood of Christ which is needed to extinguish the flames which I am consumed with. And it is the holy sacrifice which will deliver me from this frightful moments. And he tells him, I implore you, keep your word and refuse me not this justice. And after that, Blessed Henry Suso realizes that what a grave error. And he goes and he celebrates the Mass. And after a certain period of time, this blessed soul comes to him again, but in a different condition, very joyful, surrounded by a beautiful light. And he says, thanks be to you, my dear friend, that today I behold the face of my Savior and I'm delivered from my sufferings. Okay, remember that the two truths which the church stresses on is one, that there is a purgatory, and the second, that the souls in purgatory are assisted by our prayers, especially the sacrifice of the Mass. All right, now remember that even the smallest and the smallest sins will face a very rigorous punishment. Okay, what happens is one case that a soul comes to this Dominican religious just to show him, all right, that the fire is so much. So he comes to this Dominican, and he says that because he wanted to give him an idea of the torment of the fire of purgatory, he just touches the table and that whole table is burnt. That table was there for a very long time until it got destroyed in the Middle Ages. So it shows that we think of it as a light fire. It's not. Now, there is another example of another saint. Okay. Now, this is Venerable Stanislaus Chukotka. Okay. He wanted to know what is the kind of torments. So one day, one religious comes and he beseeches Stanislaus for prayers. And that person is suffering tremendously and there are flames all around and it's intolerable. And she says that the fire on earth is like a breeze compared to the fire in purgatory. And to give him, he says, let me know what is this torment like. You know, I want to understand. Feel this torment. She says, no human being on earth will be able to endure such torment. The torment is so much, no human being will be able to endure. However, it was permitted by God for that, for Venerable Stanislaus to have a light, in light to understand what that torment was. So what happens is, the soul tells Venerable Stanislaus to extend his hand. Okay, so he extends his hand, and from this soul, what seems like sweat, okay, a drop of sweat, it is a liquid, they're not sure whether it's sweat, a drop of it falls on the hand of Venerable Stanislaus Chukotka, and he falls to the ground, fainting to the ground in such terrible pain that his people had to come rushing to help him. After that, from that moment on, he was confined to his bed for 1 year in the most cruel suffering caused by his terrible wound. And then for the last time, he tells his people to remember that the divine punishment is very, very rigorous. So just imagine, one sweat falls and see, he will not, and the soul clearly tells him that you cannot, a person on earth is not able to bear that torment. Another example. Okay, now this is for us to understand that it is better to make reparation here on earth rather than waiting for purgatory, because we really have no understanding of the pain and the torments in purgatory. Okay, so there is this religious man, he's suffering from a long painful sickness for a long time, and then he gets very discouraged, and then he tells God, allow me to die, you know, so that he didn't want to suffer the pain anymore. Now, he didn't realize that his sickness was prolonged because of the mercy of God, who wished to spare him the suffering, the later suffering, okay? But in answer to his prayer now, God sends an angel, a guardian angel, to offer him a choice, okay? A choice, listen to the choice. Either to die immediately and submit to the pains of purgatory for 3 days, only 3 days, or to bear his sickness for another year, and then go directly to heaven. Okay. Now, the sick man, poor sick man, he has no idea. So what he does is he chooses the 3 days of purgatory. All right. And he lets go of that 1 year of suffering. Without hesitation, he chooses 3 days of purgatory. Now, after the lapse of 1 hour, this angel goes to visit him in his sufferings, because the guardian angels and our angels come there to console us and to be with us. Okay, they come to visit us. Now, on seeing him, now the sick man is complaining, you left me so long in these torments, you only told me 3 days, And here I'm there for so long, for so many years. So the guardian angel asks him, how long do you think you have already suffered? So he said that, no, I've suffered for now for so many years and you have told me only 3 days. Now see the angel's response. The angel tells him that you have been there only for 1 hour, only for 1 hour. And this, the poor soul says, alas, with a sigh, and he says, I have been very blind and inconsiderate in the choice that I have made. He says, pray God, my good angel, to pardon me, to return to earth, and I'm ready now to submit to the most cruel sicknesses, not only for a year or two, but as long as it pleases him. Don't forget this example, because it is better, it's better, any day is better to suffer here than to suffer in purgatory. A lot of people don't talk about it and take it very lightly. No, it's better. Do your reparation here. Do your amendments here. It's not difficult. Just follow what the saints say. Read the little way of Saint Therese of Lisieux. You'll understand in the little things that you do every day, you will be expiating your sins. There's another example. Do I have time or should I... A few more stories or should I?
Yes, just another 5-10 minutes more. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So I will just spend this time in giving you examples of the true stories which have been given by the saints to us. Yeah. And if required, I will also send these to you. I'll put it in a Word document and I'll send it to you. You know, man tends to forget things, so it's a good reminder, and you have to keep reminding ourselves because we are just human. But the mercy and grace of God is there. Okay. Now, this is given to us by a priest, two religious, eminent virtue means they are virtuous people, okay? And both were leading a holy life. Now, they both died and one of them fell sick. And he learned in a vision that should he soon die, he should be saved and that he should remain in purgatory until the first mass should be celebrated for the repose of his soul. So he tells his friend, you know what, that it's a similar example, but he tells his friend that I've been given to know that I will be in purgatory for a very short time, only until the first mass is said, and that not to delay the mass celebration for him. Now he dies the following morning, and his companion doesn't waste time and celebrates the mass, and as usual is sitting in the making a thanksgiving of after mass, this soul comes to him and he tells him very sweetly, he says, my blessed brother, why did you delay so long to celebrate the first mass? So the brother is saying, I delayed long? I didn't understand you. He's saying, didn't you leave me for a year before offering the first mass for the repose of my soul? And this person says, it's similar to the earlier example, that I started the mass immediately after your death and not even 15 minutes have passed from the time you have died. So just imagine. And remember, I don't know, but a lot of people, a lot of our family members, relatives, you know, delay these days, there is a lot of delay in offering mass for the departed souls. From this message, from this example, we can understand that it's always better not to delay, that person, that soul gets repose as soon as possible. And the blessed Eucharist, the sacrifice of mass, is the greatest repose that we can ever give. This one is about divine justice, okay? And to fervent souls, so those who are on the way to sanctity and still the justice is so great, okay? This person dies in an order of sanctity at a monastery in Paris, and one of his brethren in religion, he thought that this person who has died has led such a perfect life that he has gone directly to heaven. Okay, he thinks he's led a perfect life, gone directly to heaven. So it doesn't require masses, and he omits. Omits means he doesn't say the mass for him, the three masses of obligation. which was supposed to be said for him. And then the soul comes to him and said, why did you do this? Why didn't you assist me? So this person is saying, the religious saying, what happened? Why do you need my assistance? He's saying, I thought you were already entered into eternal glory. And then the soul says, see this, no one can believe with what severity God judges and punishes his creatures. Okay, even the smallest fault. Just imagine someone who thought that this person is directly in heaven and had no need of prayers, and he omitted the masses for him, and the soul comes to him and tells him, why did you do this? Why did you not assist me? So just imagine, these are very holy people and still they are punished. And it is time that we look inside ourselves. It's not only for you, it's for me as well, as to where we stand in this day and age, who do so much of little penance, little mortification, no amends, no reparation. Yes. Now, this is another one, again, of the least faults. I'll do this later because we've taken that topic earlier. I'll tell you about this. The second, another one where the soul comes is, this person was a religious and he didn't pray for the souls of the dead, and he had to be in purgatory for a long time. So I'm telling you, the sins for which especially those who are accountable for souls have to go through a more rigorous punishment. So if the priests, or they don't pray for the souls, then they have to go through very rigorous punishment. There is another holy prelate, when he was in his office, he saw a horrible apparition, a specter. He saw that a soul had basically come to him, and there was a collar of fire around his neck. Okay. So first the saint asks him, who are you? So the soul tells him, I am the soul for the other life. And he asks him, why is it that you are in such a sad condition? So he tells him that the soul was formerly the king of Ireland. His name was Malachi. Okay. He said that I could have done a lot of good, but I didn't do. Because I was a king, I could have done a lot of good. I didn't do. And that's why I am punished now. He's saying, the religious asks, the saint asks him, did you not do penance for your faults? He says, I didn't do enough penance for my faults. But what he did was, he made his confessor also little lax. And what did he offer the confessor? He offered him a gold ring. So he was lax in making penance. He got the confessor also to be a little lax and bent towards him. And today, that's why that fire of that collar around his neck was seen. It is said, this is the example, it is said that the punishment that you receive is basically on the types of faults and sins that you have committed in this life. Now, another example, have you heard of Saint Vincent Ferrer?
Yes.
He is a very well-known saint and specially used for the Jews. So he had his sister, okay? He was very, very holy, but his sister didn't believe. And she was living a very worldly life, full of the spirit of the world, intoxicated with pleasures and in the world. Okay. The saint prayed for her conversion, kept praying for her conversion, and it was answered. She falls mortally sick. And at the moment of her death, she makes a confession with sincere repentance. Okay. And some days after her death, when Saint Vincent Ferrer was celebrating the holy sacrifices, she comes to him amidst the flames and says, see what she says. Alas, my dear brother, I am condemned to undergo these torments until the day of the last judgment, but you can still help me. She says, the efficacy of the holy sacrifice is so great, offer for me about 30 masses and I may hope that I get the happiest result. So she tells him that she's condemned till the last day, That is the last final judgment. But she tells him that the mass is so efficacious that you offer 30 masses for me. These are also called the Gregorian masses, when you offer a set of 30 masses, which you can still offer for the souls. Okay. And then he does that. He hastens to do this and he celebrates the 30 day of masses. And won't believe it, on the 30th day, his sister again comes to him, this time surrounded by angels and soaring into heaven. Thanks be to the sacrifice of the Holy Mass. The sentence of till the end of the judgment was reduced to 30 days. But this happens, is a very rare instance. Okay? It's a very rare instance that the punishment has come down to such a level. But we are nobody to judge. God decides. But yes, the mass is very, 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 very powerful. All right. So these are the few stories, and important of them I want to stress is that you have to pray, pray for the souls in purgatory, because we do not know the fate of a soul. We do not know, but we are called to pray for them, and they will pray for us once they go to heaven. Amen. So I end my teaching. I hope I myself get inspired to pray more for the holy souls in purgatory, that we are not lax, and God bless us and all of us, inspire us and lead us into his ways of holiness and prayers and a love for the holy souls. They are called holy because they are holy. They are the elect. They will see God. Okay. They are called poor because they cannot pray for themselves, but we have to pray for them whilst they are in purgatory, experiencing the greatest torments and most excruciating pains. So God bless and be blessed.
Thank you, sister. Wonderful preaching. Very wonderful. Very nice. I'm sure many have benefited.